morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
There's a scene in my very favourite Batman film, Batman Begins, where Bruce Wayne, who is the man underneath the batsuit, is having a conversation with his trusted butler and confidant, Alfred. And he's been going through some really challenging times. He's had some real struggles as Batman. And it seems that no matter what he tries, he just keeps falling flat on his face. And he's relaying this to Alfred. And he's telling him that it feels like a complete failure. And he's ready to just give up. And Alfred just stops. And he looks at him and he says, "Why do we fall? So that we can learn to pick ourselves back up." And that quote resonates with me for a few different reasons. Firstly, because it's Batman, and as you can probably see, there's no much Disney resonate. But secondly, it's a reminder that even the strongest of people can sometimes find themselves facing the toughest of times. And that it doesn't matter how rich you are, how smart you are, how resourceful you are, there are times in life when any one of us can find ourselves falling flat on our face and having to learn to pick ourselves back up again. But the main reason that it resonates with me is because of the message behind it. The message behind that quote is one of hope and recovery. For me, two of the most important words in mental health. And more importantly, if you have somebody sitting in front of you relaying their struggles to you, that you might be looking through that struggle in order to find the strength that lies underneath. So let me tell you a story. 15 years ago, I was in a very similar position to most, if not all of you in the room here today, in that I was in the NHS. I was working in the NHS. I was an NHS paramedic. I'd been for 12 years. And in fact, I was a helicopter paramedic. I was the first female in Scotland to hold that role. And I was very chuffed with myself for achieving that and for getting to that level, because the path there had not been without challenges. And still never thought to say, "Whoa, okay, this has happened to you, but let's put that aside and remember who Lindy is. Let's talk about where you've come in the past 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. Let's talk about the challenges you've had in your life. Remind me how you overcame them again." We'll get back to that in a minute, we'll sort that out. But instead, it all became focused on that. It all became focused on my symptoms. And because I was feeling so low and so bad and so lost, that I acquiesced my care to her. So when she said, "You've got stress," all right, I've got stress. When she said, "You've got depression," and then with my psychiatrist, by that time, as a psychiatrist, that worked. Just means you have to listen to what she says, doesn't it? And talking to people today, they still feel that their treatment is very deficit focused. In fact, I was doing some research for my master's, and I was looking at the recovery colleges. I don't know if you're aware of the recovery colleges that are popping up everywhere. Most of them are sort of tend to focus on addictions, but there are some that I'm looking towards, like depression, mental health. And I was looking at a couple in Scotland, but the main page was, "Are you suffering from depression? Here are symptoms." You know, here are the top 10 things you should never say to somebody who's depressed. Recovery focused should be the opposite of deficit. It should be all the strengths, all the positivity, all the optimism. And again, I can't help feel I've kind of lost sight of what recovery actually means. And so while I maybe didn't have the resources to get myself fully back on track, I should have been part of that process. There should have been some sort of collaboration with me in terms of, okay, we are all going to come together and we're going to fight this together, but you're an integral part of this. How do you think that's going to happen? That's another thing, statistics, and I'm guilty of this as well. When I gave my TED talk, 1 in 4 people will suffer from mental health problems this year. But how many people are recovering? How many people are not using the services anymore? Where are those statistics? I think they are as important, especially to people who have it and don't want it. Because that brings hope. If we're just saying that it's almost just known as if everybody's going to get mentally ill, they're going to stay mentally ill forever. And when somebody does that to you, you don't just dismiss it as, oh, I'm not going to need it. It makes you feel worse because it reminds you that you can't pick up a simple leaflet and read it the way anybody else would. And the person that's there supposed to be helping you doesn't understand that because he's giving you six of them. Some point down the line, I went to see my psychiatrist again in Stirling, and it was my usual psychiatrist, and I was in a really, really bad place, and I was sobbing my heart out, and there was snot everywhere, and I hadn't washed for like what seemed forever. I wasn't quite in my pyjamas, but you can imagine the scene. And I can't even remember what I was saying to him, but at one point, he reached across the table and he took my hand, and he said, Linda, you are going to get better. But something deep inside me grabbed onto those four words. I call it my driftwood. Grabbed onto those four words and held onto them throughout my recovery. A psychiatrist said to me, that's the first time anybody had done it. You are going to get better. It was a bit like a slap in the face because, and I don't even know how to describe it before then, but you think that's you, you think that's your life, and you think that's your existence. And for somebody, so, you know, an expert to be sitting in front of you saying, you are going to get better. And he said, I don't know how long it's going to take, but you are going to get back to the person you were before. He was wrong, because I'm way stronger than the person I was before. It's about giving people hope, and it's about looking at people's strengths as opposed to their perceived weaknesses. It's taking them away from this idea that they're suffering and putting them into a mindset of, I'm a warrior. I'm a warrior fighting a battle that most people will never understand. That doesn't make you weak. That makes you a superhero. Superheroes are just ordinary people trying to do extraordinary things. And when you're somebody who's dealing with mental illness, you're trying to do something extraordinary. And so it's about moving away from this whole deficit medical model. I'm not saying there's not a place for the medical model, because I think there is, but moving people towards looking at their strengths, recognising their strengths. Because I asked you a minute ago to think about your strengths. Put up your hand if it was really easy. So 4, 5, 6 people. And that's the problem, I think, because if you look at all this psychological research, we certainly, in the UK, and pretty much more in Scotland, we are no good at recognising our own strengths. We don't like to big ourselves up too much. And yet, if we can't recognise our own strengths, how are we supposed to help other people to recognise their strengths? And sometimes it's up to the people who are trying to make it better, to find those strengths, to tweak out those strengths, and then to use those strengths to try and move that person forward. It means encouraging people to take responsibility for their own well-being. And I think that is so, so important. And I think more people would take responsibility for their own well-being if they were offered that chance. Take something as being as low as you can get before you realise that. So that's a gift I'm very grateful for. It's given me a real love of life, for sure. But the best thing of all, I became mum. And I put the word in my hand.